For years, opponents of abortion have warned that its legalization will lead to treating human beings as commodities. And in fact, legal abortion leaves us no alternative than to view the child as the property of its mother, something that can be treasured or disposed of depending on her whims. To see just where this mentality leads, take a look at the practice of uterine lavage, a technique for harvesting and selectively breeding humans, which claims to have advantages over in vitro fertilization. In a study sponsored by a reproductive genetics company from New Jersey, several dozen women in Mexico were paid $1,400 each to be artificially inseminated. After conceiving babies, their living embryos were flushed out of their bodies using a procedure called uterine lavage. Once removed from their mothers, scientists studied and experimented on the tiny living humans. Horrifying? Of course. But what's new here? Unscrupulous scientists have been manufacturing human embryos in petri dishes for years through in vitro fertilization. What's new in the Mexico study is that scientists wanted to see if they could artificially produce embryos inside the woman's own body rather than in a petri dish. Then they wanted to extract the embryos in the first days of life so that they could scrutinize these new human beings and decide which ones were genetically choice enough to deserve reimplantation. Why do it this way? Well, for two reasons. First, no big surprise here, money. It costs less to manufacture a baby in a woman's body than it does to make one in a laboratory dish. Women who have difficulty conceiving naturally can have sperm artificially inseminated, a much less expensive procedure than in vitro fertilization. It's also supposedly less painful, as it doesn't require that the woman have her eggs extracted. After she conceives, doctors use uterine lavage to flush out the embryos so that they can study them and single out the ones they deem to be deserving of life. Those human beings who are lucky enough to pass the brutal "I'm stronger than you are" test are put back in the womb, but not necessarily in the womb of the biological mother, as we'll get to in a moment. As fate would have it, some embryos in the study never got the chance to be graded by the technicians in the laboratory, because uterine lavage is not 100% successful at flushing out all the embryos. Researchers describe this predicament as a retained pregnancy. And their solution for this problem, of course, was to abort all the embryos who managed to escape uterine lavage. But there's a second reason for pursuing this research. It facilitates the desires of people who want to reinvent the meaning of marriage and the human family. The study's leader, Santiago Mune, said this on National Public Radio. "You could use this for lesbian couples when one wants to conceive the embryos and the other wants to carry the embryos. So one could have the embryos fertilized and then the embryos are transferred to the other woman to carry them so they can share the pregnancy." Notice how all the concern is focused on the self-centered desires of adults who want to transcend the limits of nature? Nobody seems to think or care about the negative consequences of a child growing up without a father, or the profound alienation that a child will experience upon learning about his or her complicated origins, or the physical, psychological, emotional, and spiritual traumas that arise when children are separated from their mothers in their earliest and most vulnerable stage in order to be prodded, studied, cataloged, judged, and then subjectively sorted for rejection or reimplantation, kind of like widgets on a factory conveyor belt. The uterine lavage study violates so many principles of ethics, it's breathtaking. But the most obvious problem is its shocking dismissal of the principle of consistent ends and means. That's the critical ethical principle that prevents us from using an evil method to achieve a good result. The innate human desire to share in the gift of procreation is a good. But when it leads us to treat real human beings as biological commodities, we participate in an evil that cannot be justified by any good end we might claim. This is precisely why the common practice of killing unborn children as a means of reducing the number of people born with congenital disorders is wrong. Screening out early human embryos for genetic problems and then killing the ones who don't measure up to our standards is an evil that undermines the goal of bringing about a good end. It amounts to nothing more than an arrogant attempt to eliminate human suffering by killing people who might have to suffer, as if any of us can really escape human suffering anyway. None of us are safe in a world that plays by those rules. The times we live in were eerily prophesied back in 1943 by C.S. Lewis. In his famous work, The Abolition of Man, Lewis wrote, "Man's conquest of nature, if the dreams of some scientific planners are realized, means the rule of a few hundreds of men over billions upon billions of men. Each new power won by man is a power over man as well." So how do we respond to the travesty of little humans being reduced to commodities and treated like raw materials that can be manipulated to serve the designs of others? Well, the first step is to remember that we've been here before. Human slavery is a perfect example. This evil has plagued human civilization for thousands of years. The second step is to remember that slavery was abolished in most places only after a moral consensus was built around the truth that all men and women are created equal and are possessed of equal dignity and rights. If we take an honest look at the broad expanse of history, the idea that all men and women are created equal does not seem to be intuitive. It took a concerted effort by tens of thousands of cultural influencers to forge a new consensus that supplanted the old one. People like Santiago Mune, the leader of the Mexico study, seem unable to grasp that a six-day-old embryo is actually a boy or girl with an eternal destiny, endowed with the power to change the world for the better. We must work harder to restore a sense of the sacred about human life, and to condemn and push back every attempt to treat human beings as objects of our own making.